are happy to announce that our institute has established Institution Innovation Council IIC, that is an initiative by MHRD, Government of India, at our institute, for which this series of lecture is being arranged for students and faculty members to take benefit and spread awareness about innovation, startup, intellectual property rights, and internship domain. We would like to welcome all attendees for wonderful event, Design Thinking in Product Development, which is on the domain of how you can develop a product with better thinkings. We are honored to have such experienced member for this domain to educate each one of us on this topic. I would like to introduce our expert, Mr. Sandeep Karia. We welcome you, sir. Sandeep sir has experience over 21 plus years, and out of that 12 plus years of experience in project and resource management. Sandeep sir is director at Simcon Infotech, which is an Indian subsidiary of US based MNC Simcon Software Company. Sir has also passed the PMP certification for PMI in 2012, and he has taken multiple sessions and full day workshops for the students and working professional in the past for project management process and the tools. So we welcome you, sir, for today's session. We have Dr. Hemal Shah, sir, the principal of Institute of Computer Technology, in panel with us. Sir has more than 20 years of academic experience and administration technical experience in the field of computer science and engineering. So we welcome you, sir. And we would also like to welcome each panel members and the other faculty members for giving their valuable time for such events and grow themselves in each domain. We heartily welcome you all on behalf of Ganpat University. So let's start and grab this opportunity to learn something new. I would like to start with Honorable Dr. Hemal Shah, sir, to welcome our expert. Okay, now we would like to request our expert, Sandeep sir, to start the session.
Yes, Kunal. Can you make me presenter so that I can share my screen?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So I hope my presentation is visible for everyone.
Sir, it is visible.
Okay. Yeah. Good afternoon, friends. So it is a very good initiative from Ganpat University, and thank you, Kunal and Ganpat University, to give me opportunity. So today's topic is quite interesting, and it is not related to any domain. But before I begin, I just want to know from Kunal or all of you, like that from which engineering background you are, right? Or are you from masters or like
all of them are bachelors.
Which one?
Bachelors.
Semester four and semester six. Okay, great. So it is very good that in this age you started learning this type of processes and technology. So I think Kunal already gave me my introduction, and during this lockdown I also gone through IBM Design Thinking Practitioner certification, and from that like I start gaining interest in design thinking. So mainly like today's agenda will be like we'll come to know like what is design thinking, why you should go for design thinking, and how actually you can implement design thinking wherever you are working. So at Miss, we might be thinking in project development or like product development, but design thinking doesn't have any boundary that it is only for some physical thing, right? It can be done for any problem solving. So we'll see like with one case study, which is not even like project or product, but some scenario. So I will like to begin this with one very famous quote that we can't solve problems by using the same kind of thinking we used when we created them. So generally, like all the problems are only created by human only. And if we still keep on thinking same thing, we cannot solve that problem effectively, right? So we need to do something different. We need to think out of box. And that is what design thinking is all about. So is anyone can tell me like what is common between these four companies, these logos I have kept over here? Kunal, can they like unmute themselves or they can use chat maybe to respond so that we can keep it interactive? So can anyone tell what is common, like can you think of like how IBM, Johnson & Johnson, Kellogg's and Boeing related? All four mostly are from different industry, like not related to each other. So what is common? Can anyone tell me? They are MNCs, good. Aditya? Anything else? Okay, so let me answer it like these companies are were in Fortune 500 in 1955 and still in 2019 or even 2020, it is still in Fortune 500 company. So there are very few companies who can sustain their level across the 60, 70 years. So 90% of companies who were there in 1955 list is either bankrupt or merged with other company or altogether disappeared from the list. Maybe like they are not in top 500, they might be at bottom level. So what are the lessons learned from that? That today's strength might be tomorrow's weakness. So earlier they were on top, but they cannot sustain at that position because they might be thinking they have some very good strength, but that can become weakness soon. Competitive advantage has limited lifespan, right? So earlier other companies might have that competitive advantage, but competitors are also working and innovating, right? So that will not sustain if you don't do any new thing. You need to think for end user needs before they come and ask. People will not come to you and say that I need this if other companies are giving that. So you need to get that information that what end user need. So there are a couple of famous examples you can see. So first one is like this normal razor. Maybe your father or even grandfather might use that. So this is four piece razor where you need to like disconnect and use this sopas and all other old style blade and then use for shaving. And then it replaced with this use and throw twin or like triple blade razors, right? So this is something like earlier 90% of people were using and that replaced suddenly with this disposable thing. And even more like famous example, if you even see that in childhood or your father might see in this roll-based camera where you have restriction that you can have 24 or 36 photos only. You need to think before you click the photo. And nowadays, like digital camera, even mobile camera, like people are just using that without much thinking and then deleting it like whatever is not required, right? This replacement happened. Why? Because people think about end user as of use and they innovate new product. And because of that, like companies like Kodak and Topaz like need to either change their product or they become obsolete. Some of the recent example I would like to see. So this is a very good example of social distancing, where just milkmen did this type of technique so that people can take milk from distance. Now, this people may say like this jugaad, so that is a famous term for that, but that also has some thinking of, you can say, design thinking before they thought about end user. Another example of this bank where credit and debit card both come in single card. You might see like if people have too many cards in their wallet, and it is very difficult to even sit if you put a wallet at the back pocket, right? So such innovation is again like thinking for end user, where single card can do dual purpose. This is another example, and this is an example from Sweden, metro station. Now this stairs and this accelerator are mainly for senior citizen, and they expect that youngsters would use this stair. But they have problem, and they see the problem that everybody started using accelerator because nobody wants to go for normal stair. And they solve their problems with very innovative way. So if you see over here, like they change the staircase such that it worked like piano, not only by color, like it also gives some music. And soon they did this change, their problem got solved very quickly, and all the youngsters or whoever can like climb from normal stairs started using that because of this want to experience this new thing. So this is also one good example of people solve their problem in different ways. Okay, so now let's see like a basic definition of what is product. So product is in between users, or you can say customer and company. It should address a problem or provide a benefit to a group of people. And on other hand, it generates revenue, helps to sell another product or service, or serve some another business goal. Because sometimes it may happen that people or company, you can say, like do not do this business only for money, but they may have some promotional activity or branding or some other business goal in behind. So products should be solving this two purpose in a general. Now, this is a very good matrix of, you can say, in x-axis you can see the need or requirement, and on y-axis you can see product or situation. So if your need is known and your product is known, that is called commodity. And simple example like toothpaste, right? So there is nothing like innovation in this quadrant, first quadrant. Second quadrant is futuristic product, where you know need of end user, but your product is still not in market. It is not mature. Again, like there is an example of driverless car. Like people are doing lots of trials, but still like it is not in the market. So that is little bit of futuristic product. Third quadrant is potential disruptor or game changer, where nobody knows the requirement and even product is not there, right? So something unique. So that is something even like not there in market. And if you work in either two or three quadrant, that is where you need innovative things and design thinking on all the other concepts. And quadrant four is you can say failed product, where you know the product is there, but actually end user doesn't require that, or maybe like for compliance reason, like it got failed. So that example is Google Glass. Like people doesn't accepted that, and it comes like before actually customer or end user want that type of product. And this is a one good example of what is innovation. So innovation is intersection of business viability, technical feasibility, and people desirability. We need all these three to get the innovation. Think about like if this is business viable, right? So there is a business viability and technical feasibility, but people don't want it. So that will become a functional innovation, but it is not true innovation. If you think like technically it can be done, people also want it, but there is no business. There is no viability in business. Then it is just a process innovation. And if business can be done, people want it, but technically it is not possible, it will, then it is emotional innovation, but it will not become practical. So to make innovation practical, you need all these three, right? So let's now come to the definition of design thinking. So design thinking is especially helpful for solving wicked problems, and it should have this six factors. So it should be human centered, very important thing that human should be there in center. It should have mindfulness of processes. It is all about showing and not telling. It is all about practical thing, prototyping. So you need not to say that it can be done like this. So you need to prove it. You need to prototype and then let user test it. It is biased towards action, again, like prototyping. It is not something like just paperwork and commitment. It required lots of collaboration, radical collaboration, because you need to keep on communicating with all the stakeholders and mainly end users. And it has that culture of prototyping. And three important E's of design thinking. First is empathy, very important thing, because you need to empathize with end user. Expansive thinking, you need not to think quite narrow. It should be like, you can say, you need to do a telescope view instead of microscope. So you need to think out of box, you need to see from the distance. And you need to be ready with experimentation, because you need to do lots of trial and error to solve that problem, test it, and then again check with end user. Okay, so now let's begin with our main topic, design thinking as a big picture. Wherever you go, wherever you search, these five terms will be always there in design thinking and this loop. So this is quite important slide for knowing design thinking, and we'll go all this five in detail. So first is emphasize. So design thinking will start with empathy, and that is all about understanding people, people who are going to use your product. Second is define. You are on all from engineering students, right? So you might be knowing SDLC, right? So how many of you know SDLC, and what all, like, you can say, what all aspects are there, right? So what all steps you need to follow in software development lifecycle? Can anyone tell me? Yeah, students? Did you learn SDLC in your college? Software engineering.
Six students have learned. Six SEM students. Fourth SEM students are remaining.
Okay. So SDLC is something like requirement analysis, design, development, testing, right? So generally in software. Yeah. Software development lifecycle. Yes, I'm talking about that. So I'm just trying to correlate like what you studied with design thinking, right? So in software development lifecycle, you have like requirement analysis, design, then development, testing, release, right? So that type of thing. So this is very similar, but with different terminology, little bit of different concept. So it starts with empathize, where you need to understand people. So During requirement analysis, again, you need to do that, right? You might be going and interviewing those end users to get the requirement. So, but here, as it is human-centric, it gives more importance to empathize. So that is a very separate stage where you understand people. Then it will come for defining that problem, because design thinking is not something like you need to do very simple, non-requirement type of like, you can say software or product. So that is not required for going for design thinking. So when there is a complex problem, wicked problem, you need to go for that. So you need to figuring out what is current problem. Then it will come over here, ideate. It is all about generating ideas. Because as this is a complex problem, you cannot solve, you may need to do brainstorming and come up with different ideas. Then you may need to go for prototyping, because it is all about action, right? So you need to prototype, experiment. So creation and experimentation will come over here, and then you need to test it. You need to test it, you need to ask end user to test it, and then you can see this loop. It is continuous infinite cycle type of loop where you need to keep on repeating all these five steps till you think that you have very great product, you have innovative product, or you solve your problem in an efficient way. So that is all about design thinking, five stages. We'll go this stage one by one in detail. So before we go for this stage, like I need to like run one parallel story so that you can correlate all these five stages, how that problem is first solved. So instead of like going for some software development or very fixed thing, I am just saying like normal scenario or problem. So in COVID-19, that all IT companies started working from home, right? And you are also started studying from home remotely. Now what happened is in one IT company, I will not tell the name, but suddenly like there is a declaration from top management that you need to start working from office from this Monday. Like maybe like Wednesday or Thursday, they say from Monday, you all need to come to the office. Now all employees are distributed, some of their local, some of are from out of state, and they suddenly get this news. All has that question, why? Nobody is knowing except management, and nobody go and check with management. They ask for to department manager, and department manager half-heartedly agreed with management. But internally he also don't agree that it should be done at current time of COVID-19. And employees obviously are not ready to working from home. Now this story is a little bit of last Diwali time, October, November time, where people are like quite afraid about it. And in IT companies, people were not working from office at that time. Now we need to keep this story in mind, because after every stage we'll show like how this story will flow with each stage, right? So if anybody has any question, like you can like chat with or you can ask in between, because it is very important to understand these five stages to understand the design. So very first stage is empathize, as we know. Now again, like I would like to ask, like how many of you during this lockdown like work with your mother in cleaning your house or cleaning the like your cups and dishes, right? So how many of you work like that? Anyone? A student? Anyone help your mother? Yes. Deepak say, yeah. So, and most of the time what happened is like before you did that, before you work for your mother, you might be thinking that whatever your mother or your sister is doing is not that hard, right? So it is a quite easy job. That is what our thinking is. Even I also did, and I was thinking that my wife, whatever she is doing, is not that difficult. But when you work what your mother or sister is doing, you will start understanding what is their problem, how difficult that task is. So it is all about this, empathize. Understand the user's problem. You need to put yourself in shoes of end user. You might need to work what end users are doing, or you might need to stay with them to understand like how they are working. You also need to emotionally attach with that subject. So whatever problem is there or whatever product you want to develop, you need to understand how end users are working. You need to remove all your bias and assumptions, because many times what happened that during requirement or during any product definition, you think like it might be like this, or they might be working like that. So there is nothing like might be. You need to know what exactly users are doing day to day, right? So you need to ask question, who is actual end user? First, you need to identify that users who all are going to use your product, services, or whatever, and what is their current problem, which you need to solve. So this is all about empathize. And there are some tools, technique, like which you need to use. So mainly you need to observe, engage, and immerse. And there are various methods to doing that. So one method might be research. Now, because whenever you are creating some product, it is not required that users are with you or you, they are approachable. So you might need to do like online research. If they are approachable, you can visit them online or like in person. Interviews are best thing, because you can directly connect with that end user. If number of users are too many, you may need to do survey. You need to ask effective question and take survey. Shadowing. Best method for empathizing is shadowing, where you sit with them, you sit behind them and observe how they are working. Now, assume that you are creating some software application for some store, and people are coming and people need to get bill out of your system. Now, many times when people report that problem that this transaction is taking 20 seconds or 15 seconds, as a developer, we might think like it is not a big deal, right? But when you see the end user's problem, when you sit behind them, you will feel like how much difficult for them when some transaction is taking 15 seconds and there is a queue in front of them. So this type of empathy will allow you to solve wholeheartedly their problem and to come to know like what area you need to focus first, what you need to prioritize. Another things are documentary, general, or observing body language. Body language is again important thing. Many times what happened that end users are not that open. They will not say what is the problem upfront. You also need to observe their body language, where they are like getting frustrated from your product. And after all this data, you may need to do quantitative and qualitative analytics. You need to collect data from various users, because many times there may not be like very simple couple of users product, right? You might have lots of roles engaged with you, lots of different level of users. You also need to understand the feelings and needs, problem and pain point, because you need to identify based on their tone, their language, right? So all the soft skills you also need to develop. And main important thing is you need to drop all your judgment, assumption, and bias and work on actual data. Right? So this is all about empathize. And here, like this is one example of empathy map. So remember I said one story where people need, like IT company need to come and start working from office. So in that, once we see the resistance from employee, what we did is like we get the survey, or we get this empathy map where employee need to stick the sticky notes on this board, and it is anonymous, right? So people will not know like which employee said what, and we also need to discuss with them and identify what they think, what they hear from outside, what they say and do. That is what upfront you are getting from that, and what they see out, and also gain and pain. So this six factors you need to get out of those employees, and then you need to put it on a paper or whiteboard or in any other area where you can judge that what is their actual problem. So that is an outcome of empathize, and management come to know like that employee started thinking that there is lack of trust. They started thinking company don't care about their employees. Yeah. And they hear from management that productivity is low. They also face internet and hardware issues at their home. Right. And their main impact is safety from COVID-19. So all these factors we need to get from users. Okay, so we finished that empathize phase. So second phase is define. Define is very similar to your requirement analysis thing. We need to create very basic problem statement. And key element is to understand the target user. So this problem statement should take input from your empathize phase. Whatever you learn from shadowing, interviewing end user, based on that, you need to create problem statement, not based on what is said by management and what is you learn from initial meeting with top management. You need to know what end user's problem. You need to construct point of view based on actual user's need, and you need to redefine and focus on user-based input you got from empathy phase. And here the question is, what are insights we can use in a product? Many times in empathize, you may get lots of information. Some of them might not be used for your product, but you need to filter it out, like what all we can use from that phase for our product. So here, like a couple of examples you can refer based on that you can know, like how your problem definition change after empathize or within design thinking. So without design thinking, one company has a problem statement or target, you can say that we need to increase our food product market share among young teenagers by 5%. Very simple MBA type of thing, like where people give this type of task. But with problem design thinking, this problem definition got changed. The teenager needs to eat nutritious food in order to thrive, be healthy and grow. This is something quite different. You might think like as a management how it is relevant, but here it is not about increasing your sales by 5%. Here it is all about increasing awareness in the market for young and teenager students. And automatically your market will increase. So many type in TV, you might see the advertisement where they are just promoting that you should eat protein, you should eat good food, right? You need to take herbal things, like so that type of thing. It is irrespective of your company's promotion. And automatically, if overall market will increase 15-20%, your sale will also. Or here, like another example is like how can our economy keep going in COVID-19. So again, country level people might be thinking, but instead of that, like we can even think like how we can keep our local economy most healthy in long term with minimum loss of life and livelihood in our community and neighbors community. Again, like what our Indian government do, like where they can balance with people's life and livelihood. Like there was a lockdown, but not continuous lockdown like European countries. They think about neighborhood countries and communities. So that is all about like more vast thinking, like telescopic view and think out of box. So in our example, our earlier problem statement was, let's start working from office as working from home has technological issue and background noise. So that is what earlier management decision was. But after emphasizing phase, they redefined the statement that how employee can continue working from home with proper safety. So again, end user come into picture, their safety come first, but still collaborate with customer without any technical issue and background. So whatever problem they want to solve, that should be solved, but with proper safety of employee. So this is how that definition of problem changes after this. And in idiot, like how, what all factors you need to do? So you need to brainstorm a range of crazy and creative ideas based on defined stage. So this is a third stage of design thinking where people come together and generate their ideas based on problem statement. And there should be lots of ideas where you can filter it out. It should not be like just working from on a single idea. We need to do out of box thinking, go beyond your rational thinking, broad search for solution. It is not like narrow minding. Very good tools is brainstorming. You might be like using in a college. Brain writing is another tool, and the SCAMPER. So this is acronym which about like substitute. You might need to substitute some of the ideas. You might need to combine 2-3 ideas together. You might need to adapt some of the ideas. Some ideas might be modified. Some ideas you may need to use in another use, put in another use. Some ideas might be eliminated because that might not be practical or in line with current problem. Or even you might need to reverse your ideas. Somebody might say something crazy, but once you think more about that, there might be something, some other ideas from that idea. So this is all the tools we use in IDEAT. So once we get together in a company and started generating idea about working from home and noise problem, people start giving ideas like company should give high quality headphone and earphone. We need to create SOP to let employee know about expectation. Because we come to know with the employees that they even don't know that this is a problem. They even think like it is normal to have some background noise while we are working from home. So we need to create some operating procedures. We also need to give purchase and give some good internet line to the employees. We need to give free stay to employee nearby hotel. If some employees are outside, they cannot stay in PG, so we may need to some facilitate so that they need to transport from long distance. We may need to rent some house and keep employee in that. So that is another idea. Again, these are ideas, right? It is not necessary that everything will be implemented, but this type of ideas we got. We may need to rent a cab for pick up and drop facility so that they need not to travel from public transport. So this 5-6 top ideas we got from our brainstorming session. So once we have ideas, so we finish the three stage. We empathize with users, we define our problem statement, and we generate some ideas. Now it is a time to prototype idea. We may need to put it on paper and put it something live, right? So you need to take ideas you want to develop. So maybe you can take top two, top three ideas to start with and turn them into testable physical objects. Now again, here physical object, if it is like some thing where user can drive, or it may be like even software, it may be something like object, model, or even role-playing activities where people can try with that. Or just like in software, we have that UI, just interface or clickable UI, people will try and then give their opinion. Or it can be even storyboard, right? So we say, like in Agile, we have that storyboarding. So even that will also start giving some input. Mainly, this prototype should start solving your disagreement and start some conversation with end user. Because it's when you go to the end user, people are saying like, seeing is believing, and we need to start trying something before we give more input, right? So because they cannot give their inputs in just verbally or in meetings, but once they start seeing, they will feel like यहाँ पे ऐसा होता तो अच्छा होता, ये थोड़ा बड़ा होना चाहिए. That type of input will start giving once they have some hands-on. And we also need to fail fast concept, right? So we need to, we don't want to like complete our complete product before we start getting input, right? Because this is agile world, people start like going by scrum. So that's why prototyping is a good idea before we start and build lots of other code behind that. And mainly it will continue solution building process. So in our real life story, like as this is something like processes. So we just started creating SOP, drafted, like, so we created one SOP and just getting reviewed by people. We identify only a couple of employees where there is lots of noise issue, and we give some better headphone. We also identify some employees where they have internet issues over there, and then we give some good 40 Mbps line to them. And we also purchase some WebEx account where we have option to connect from phone, local phone instead of internet, so that they can use that while discussing with customers. So these four steps we use for prototyping, test it further. So now after this four stage, this is the fifth stage of testing, because it is quite important to test whatever you understand and how it is giving results. So idiot multiplied by prototyping is testing, where you need to test your prototype. You need to give whatever you created in your prototyping to end user. That is something like trial run or pilot, and it can redefine your problem, or you might need to rework on your solution. But that type of input should come out of this testing, and should keep on going till final go ahead will come for implementation, right? So again, in real life story, just as I say, like we started implementing and we waited for 2 weeks so that we again get input from management that now are they facing any issue with employees or not. And this is what I talk about looping, right? So from any stage to any stage, you need to go back. You may need to go from testing to directly define, or prototyping to ideate. So you may need to even go to like end users for empathizing phase after your testing, because you might think that whatever you get from end user is not enough. You might need more information. So this type of looping will keep on happening to make your product or your services, your process mature enough to go live. So this is all about like 5 stages of design thinking. And before we go for personas, like I would like a little break and ask if anybody has any question. Yeah, Kunal, is there any question from anyone from chat?
No, sir.
So now like a little bit of final thing about persona. So some of the important thing apart from this 5 stages to understand in design thinking. So persona is a fictional character designer use to reflect user types pinpointing. Now, as empathize is more important, we need to like create a personas of end user where you identify who they are and what they do with your product in relevant to the context. And This will help you to understand user characteristics, their needs, and their goals. It includes all stakeholders to accept and review. So, like, we also need to like create persona and then get it reviewed so that it is not false. So this is some example of persona where I understand like what are their behaviors, what they want. So once you go interview, once you do shadowing, this type of documents should be created and designed. In personas, there are different type of personas, like UX persona is different and marketing persona is different. And personas should be combined with multiple roles, because it may happen in your product there are too many personas because of too many roles. So if they are similar in nature, we can combine few personas together. We also need to at least speak to 5 users to create one persona, because it should not happen that you interview only one user and you understand that this role requires this type of product or this type of way of working. So that is not common. So we need to interview at least 5 users. Personal data is important in persona, so team can empathize. So generally what happen in product industry is like people don't talk much about personal thing, but here like to empathize with, to gel with that end users, like it is important. Persona's life is also there, like it is typically 1 year, because employees are keep on changing, world is changing, right? So every 1 year you may need to do again that empathize phase if it is a long-term product, to know if anything is changed in your user's expectation. You also need to describe several situation and scenario prompting that persona to the use for product. What happened like when you interview someone, like they will not come out and say upfront like what they want, right? So you may need to ask their questions by some situation or scenarios. You also need to put them in context with problem to overcome. So that tricky question should be done like that what happened or how you work in this situation when you have like queue in front of that and you need to do billing, like how you work or whatever your problem statement is, you in that scenario you need to ask questions. This is one like simple screen or photo how people use this persona, and people put that persona in a desk of developers so that they again like keep on remembering like what end user wants. Here you might see like that personality and assessment is also done, whether users are extrovert or introvert, or like judging or perceiving. So that type of thing also people observe, because they are your end user, they are your product user, and this personality will also matters how you need to give your product to them. And we also need to know what are their motivations, what are their pain points, what they want to achieve, goals, behavior. All these things are important for persona. This is little bit of IBM way, again like not much relevant for you, that how IBM work in design thinking. They have their own terminologies very similar to this. There are many tools and techniques people are using in company to get all the details. I will just go through like 4 or 5 because of time. So one is like we see like you should not have any assumptions. So once you start building your product in your requirement and empathize phase, you need to ask all your developer or requirement analysis people. You just start putting assumptions and question on whiteboard. Just take a one whiteboard and put 1-2 sections. People start putting their question over there, and then slowly in empathize phase you need to answer those assumptions, answer those questions, and once you get those answers we need to keep on removing that. Ultimate aim is that whiteboard should be empty. You should not have any pending assumptions when you go for problem statement. So this technique are people are using where there have like multiple people and they don't have common time for meeting, so they just put this whiteboard and then people keep on getting answers of those questions. Second thing is to know your stakeholder. Stakeholder might be like tricky term for you. Like stakeholder is like in your project, whoever is negatively or positively impacted by that. It might be your end user, it might be a government, it might be an opposite company, anything, contractors, right? Your internal team. So you need to create that map of stakeholders, you need to group them so that you can create persona for one group, if you can say. Another technique is like hopes and fears. So in your project, when you start discussing with like your end users persona, you start getting like what all hopes are there, where you can work positively, and then what are the fears, what are the constraints for the project, what can go wrong. That also you need to anticipate in first thing, and then you need to work with that, all the constraints, how you can overcome those constraints. So that type of techniques are also use in design thinking. Empathy map, we see like what you think, what user think and what they feel. So again, like that soft skills are coming to picture, because you need to judge what they feel, what they think, what they do. So not only what they say. So what they say is equally important, but many people don't say what they internally feel. And this is a prioritization grid. So what feature you need to take in your product, right? So again, like this is X and Y axis technique. So here the feasibility is high or low, and then value for users. So obviously whatever is most valuable and whatever is highest feasible, so that areas we should take first, so that people get very good value out of your product and with easy things, right? And then if something is low feasible and low value, that is unwise, right? So we may not need to take those features in your initial version. And this is one online collaboration tool. So as in COVID-19, like IT companies are working from home, it is not easy like to get the sticky notes. It is not easy to have whiteboard in your meeting room. So we have like one online tool called Miro. It is a nice tool, like if you want to try like to get different design thinking templates over there, where you can put online sharing. So multiple users can come in this board, and then they start putting sticky note and they start writing all the details over there. So you can create a persona, personality, like all the maps, everything is there within that world. So you can see this, how it is working quickly. I will not let complete video play, but you can see like how other users are working. Right, so this is all about like design thinking session. These are some of the references I use. Yeah, thank you. And Kunal, like, do you want to take like 2-3 questions to see like how they understand?
Okay, if any student has any doubt or any question, you are open to ask. You can ask questions to Sandeep sir. If anyone is having any question. Okay, Sandeep sir, can you stop your presentation?
Yeah.
First of all, I would like to all of you to just turn on your camera so we can take a picture. All of you, please turn on your camera. All students and faculty members are requested to turn on their camera. Remaining students, quickly, if you can turn on your camera. All the students who are remaining, they can turn on your turn their camera on. Parva, Ketan, Ashil, Harris, Dhruv, Samit. Okay, thank you everyone. See, as a vote of thanks, I would like to thanks honorable and respected Dr. Himal Shah sir, Professor Dharmesh Darji for their valuable and time, and all the staff members and all invited students. It is my privilege to offer thanks on this occasion. I, Professor Kunal Garud, on behalf of on my entire organization, would like to express sincere thanks for today's speaker and expert, Mr. Sandeep Karia, for giving best knowledge about the topic and showing gratitude for exposing his theory for the same. We are all inspired by your great words, sir. I would like to end up this session here. Thank you again for your time and support. Thank you, all of you. Thank you, Sandeep, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.